mainly ligament injuries, meniscus injuries, cartilage injuries, muscle injuries. So how one can diagnose those injuries? At the same time, what treatment options we have for such injuries? We are going to have focus on pediatric knee injuries, because nowadays we see a lot of patients, especially kids, participating in various sports. So children participation in sports is increasing day by day, and we are getting more kids with knee injuries, and treatment protocol in kids is totally different as compared to adults. So before we start, I would like to show you a knee model that will help you to understand various knee structures which we will be discussing during this presentation. So this is a knee model. This is kneecap. This is thigh bone. This is shin bone. Kneecap is in layman's language, it is called as kneecap, but technically we call it patella. So if you are able to see this, so when we take it away, this. So there is the ligament here, which you see is ACL. There are two C-shaped structures in the knee joint. On the medial side or inner aspect is meniscus, medial meniscus. On the outer aspect, it is lateral meniscus. As I showed you, ACL is in the center part of the knee. On the inner aspect of the knee, this ligament is called as medial collateral ligament. In the outer aspect of the knee, this ligament is called as lateral collateral ligament, or LCL, the standard short form used for this ligament. On the back side of the knee, this ligament is called as PCL, posterior cruciate ligament. So friends, knee joint is stabilized by these four ligaments, one on the inner aspect, outer aspect, backside, and on the center. So these ligaments give stability to the knee joint. So if there is injury to medial collateral ligament, as you can see in this knee model, knee would start opening like this, and it results in instability. Okay. So ligament, they provide great stability to the joint, and any injury to a ligament is to be taken very, very seriously. If we ignore ligament injuries, it leads to secondary knee injuries and it aggravates your problem. Now I'm going to start sharing my screen, and we are going to see the presentation. I hope you people are able to see this. Dr. Ravi, can you see this presentation? You are on mute, Ravi. Host, can you unmute Dr. Ravi Keralkar? Okay, I hope you are able to see this presentation.
Yes, Ravi, sir, we are able to see.
Okay. May I request host Sai Shri Hospital to unmute all the panelists so that we need not request you every now and then. So knee injuries, as we discussed, is a knee is a routinely injured knee joint. In US, around 25 million children participate in school sports, and another 20 million, they are active in community-based sports. So if you take into consideration India population, this number is much, much higher. And there are around 2.5 million sports-related injuries in kids annually in the US alone. And friends, around 60% of all sports injuries, knee joint is involved. So knee injuries are very common. And it is not in just professional athletes, but also in amateur athletes and in recreational athletes. So it is routinely seen in recreational persons involved in recreational activities. So pediatric knee injuries, one must remember, children are not miniature adults. So whatever treatment protocol we follow in adults, same cannot be applied in kids. Why? Because most of the lower limb growth occurs around knee joint. The picture which you are able to see this here, and there are growth plates around knee joint which are responsible for increasing the height of that limb. So any treatment which we plan for knee injuries, this growth plate, we need to take into consideration how much growth is remaining in that limb is absolutely important. The knee injury could be acute injury after a fall, or could be overuse in injury. Repetitive stress can lead to this. And there are various other injuries which we are going to see in this presentation. Clinical examination by an expert is extremely important, and majority of the knee injuries we are able to confirm on clinical examination. As you can see in this video, there is injury to the anterior cruciate ligament, ACL, and that leads to instability of the joint, and which needs repair. This again, the leg was completely rotating externally, which suggests posterolateral coronary injury, and which needs particular attention. Majority of the knee injury on X-ray, which help us to clinch the diagnosis, and which indicates certain typical ligament or related injuries. Apophysitis. So let's not complicate the matter. I think most of you must have come across the term Osgood-Schlatter disease. Typically, a kid presenting with anterior knee pain. Pain would be here in the front of the knee joint, okay? And 12, 14-year-old boy or girl presenting with front of the knee joint pain. And it is because of the partial avulsion of this ligament from the parent bone. And this can be very well treated with splinting, rest, and some medication. We need to keep knee straight, avoid knee flexion 2 to 4 weeks, and this there will be complete recovery from this condition. Various types of braces and taping, Dr. Kashmira Sapnis, our expert sports physiotherapist, is going to explain you regarding this, definitely help in such condition. Patellofemoral pain. Patella means kneecap, patella and femur. So the joint between patella and femur, the conditions are totally different, and pain would be on front of the knee joint, in front of the knee joint, not exactly at the knee joint level. And so patellofemoral pain, clinical diagnosis is important. There could be some history of trauma, injury which patient often misses, and then it leads to anterior knee pain or front knee pain. If patella dislocates, then there could be some injury to the ligament called MPFL, medial patellofemoral ligament, which leads to subluxation or instability in the patellofemoral joint. And this also can lead to cartilage injury. Cartilage is a smooth structure present on the back side of the patella, as you can see here. And if patella dislocates like this, it injures the cartilage, and definitely which needs to be tackled as a priority. As you can see in these pictures, patella is completely dislocated from its original place, and a person presents with severe knee pain and some blood collection inside joint, and recurrent dislocation of the patella. If this episode happens 2, 3, 4 times, then a person is able to feel that apprehension. If you try to smooth that patella in the outward direction, person will feel as if that patella is going to dislocate. And he or patient person will say, don't do that, doctor. It may just dislocate. That test is called as apprehension test. And MRI is useful in such cases to diagnose loose body. And loose body is nothing but a fragment of the cartilage. So when patella goes out, the undersurface or underlying cartilage is injured. Even if patella goes back to the normal location, the cartilage injured fragment remains somewhere in the joint and leads to pain and locking sensation. So this needs to be tackled arthroscopically. There are various other reasons of recurrent dislocation, which we are not going to discuss in detail in this presentation. Meniscus, as we discussed, is a C-shaped cartilage, one on the inner aspect and other on the outer aspect. So this is meniscus on the inner aspect and on the outer aspect. This acts as a shock absorber and it provides stability to the joint. There are three zones in the meniscus, as you can see in this picture: red-red zone, red-white zone, and white-white zone. Red-red zone, as name suggests, it is rich in blood supply, and any injuries in this zone, if repaired properly, will heal and it will give natural meniscus back to patient. But white-white zone is devoid of blood supply, and healing potential in this zone is very poor, and which needs to be trimmed or balanced. Okay, so as you can see in this video, if meniscus is injured, it gets displaced in the center of the joint and it will lead to locking sensation. And typically, so Marathi madhe patient mhanto, sir, mi pay vakavla ta to saral karayla tras hoto, adaklyasarkha feeling yeta. So this sensation is called as locking sensation. And this because the meniscus gets displaced in the center of the joint, and it results in severe pain and locking sensation, difficulty in walking and doing day-to-day activities. Meniscus, earlier we used to take that out, but nowadays we are able to repair the meniscus arthroscopically. So this is done through 5 millimeter portal. As you can see in this animated video, top left is actual intra-articular video. That's how we repair the meniscus through 5 millimeter portal. And the syringe goes in, and when we pull the thread, it just gets locked. Now, actually, this video is... So there are various newer devices which have come, which we are able to, you know, repair large meniscus tears also. As you can see in this video, when I pull the thread, this meniscus just gets approximated and we can repair it nicely. And knee bending or knee movement is allowed very next day after this procedure. Maximum stay required is just 24 hours. Discoid meniscus is a condition where there is meniscus is thickened or very thick meniscus. And this boy, this video we are seeing, this is a video of a six-year-old boy. Can you believe, six-year-old boy? He presented to us with severe knee pain and locking sensation. And so where we had no other option but to trim it and balance this meniscus completely, as you can see. And now he's completely pain-free. And you are able to appreciate, I believe, here that the meniscus is now completely balanced. And the boy is very happy and is back to his sports. Osteochondral or cartilage lesion over the bone can lead to severe pain, and the loose fragment like this leads to locking, which needs to be repaired properly. Majority of this lesion, if stable, can be repaired with, can be treated with medication, non-weight bearing, using a walker or a crutch, and then rest and ice fomentation. But some lesions needs to be repaired arthroscopically and some with open technique. Now coming to most common injury in the knee joint, ACL, anterior cruciate ligament injury. So ACL is a main ligament and most commonly injured ligament. So this provides stability to the joint, and it can injure, we can injure the ligament by twisting movement or a cutting movement. And ACL is a primary stabilizer of the knee joint. And if we turn, rotate knee joint, your foot is locked. If you jump, your foot is locked and body rotates through the knee joint. You can injure the ACL. It is routinely seen, more commonly seen in female athletes. And especially when you are having weak muscles, then you are likely to injure these ligaments very commonly. So here, ACL, how we diagnose it, as you can see in this video, this test is called as Lachman test. So you are able to pull your pull the tibia in front of the femur, and there is excessive movement in the femoro-tibial joint is because of the injury to ACL. MRI gives us clear picture, and then torn copy, and this can be treated non-operatively with the braces in kids, immature athletes, and kids where growth plates are open. This can be treated with brace and physiotherapy and restriction on the sports activity. But those kids who are active in their sports and they want to go back to their sports as early as possible, then we have different technique where we avoid these growth plates. As you can see in this X-ray picture here, we avoid this growth plate and still we can reconstruct the ligaments in kids with open physis or open growth plate. In adults, we don't have these issues, and ACL reconstruction is a routine straightforward procedure. And before we go ahead or we plan the operative treatment, knee braces are suggested, ice fomentation, and restriction on the activity. So typically, a couple of weeks after the injury, this surgery is recommended. There are various grafts and semitendinosus, gracilis, and bone patella tendon bone. These are commonly used grafts. And there are various techniques of ACL reconstruction, but we prefer anatomical ACL reconstruction, which helps in early return to sports and which gives stability in pivotal movements. Graft either BPTB, that is bone patella tendon bone, or hamstring. It is there are two schools of thought, and there are advantages and disadvantages of both the grafts. And surgeon decides based on the person's requirement or which sport he's participating. Based on that, the graft choice, graft is decided. And when we do ACL, we do first just diagnostic arthroscopy. We inspect, as you can see in this video, ACL was completely torn and other structures were normal. And this is how ACL is pulled inside, and the new ligament is fixed inside. So anatomical ACL, the endo button will be on the outer aspect of the femur, which is difficult to explain in during the webinar. But anatomical ACL, friends, remember, it gives more stability and recovery is much faster than the conventional ACL. Nowadays, we are performing all inside anatomical ACL, where the tunnel drilled on the outer cortex of the bone is very small, and which results in speedy recovery. And we are getting great result with all inside anatomical ACL reconstruction. And most of these patients, they need extended rehabilitation, which Kashmira is going to highlight during her presentation after my talk. So ACL, if there is ligament injury, that needs to be reconstructed. But if it is avulsed, as you can see, there are various types of this tibial eminence fracture where ACL is avulsed with the bone fragment that can be fixed like this with a screw. And in kids, we need to avoid growth plate to injure, to prevent multiple ligament injuries are common, routinely seen in soccer, kabaddi, and kho-kho players, where there is, you know, personal contact, and then they are very high demand sports and needs to be tackled in a particular way. So friends, we must remember, children are not miniature adults. When we are treating children with knee injuries, we need to give extreme importance to physis, that is growth plate, stage of development of that kid. Recurrent effusion in the knee joint, if a person is having after injury, then we should be watchful. There could be occult fracture. And if you are having knee pain, locking sensation after a fall or injury, and your x-ray is normal, please don't ignore those injuries. Consult your doctor, wherein a clinical examination or any further investigation will help you to clinch the diagnosis. Early treatment is key to success. That's what I would like to highlight. Thank you very much for patient hearing. Over to you, Dr. Ravi. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a very informative demonstration. I think it was most beneficial for sports persons, professional, amateurs, recreationals, all the same. I think we have few questions, but I would like to tell my audience that we will have a question and answer session after the next presentation by our chief sports physiotherapist, Kashmira. She is going to give us information about rehabilitation and how you can get back to sports after any knee injury or knee surgery. Over to you, Kashmira.
Thank you, Dr. Ravi. Can I share my screen?
Yes, you can. We can see your screen. You can start the slideshow and your presentation.
After surgery, mainly so. Tiger Woods' historic comeback after, even after four knee surgeries and four spine surgeries. So this was in 2019 itself. So he came back after 2008. He won the Masters the fifth time and he still rules golf. So Tiger Woods, so if he can do it, I think any player can do it. And today we are going to see the ways to how to return back to sport. And this is what I'm going to explain to you today. So football, tossing the ball through the air, then they're like rushing downfield to avoid the opposing player. And then they pass the ball, then they block the opponents, and they powerfully kick the ball through the air. So these are all the fundamental basic movements of football. Then we go to Kabaddi. So raider is the main person and there are defenders. So the raider actually like raids his opponents in a way that he runs by doing a hand touch, runs by doing a leg touch. Then he also runs by doing a frog jump. And there is something called as a dupki. And then also there is a scorpion kick. Then we go to basketball. So in basketball, the basketball player is literally flying through the air and then dunk the ball into the net. He dribbles the ball, he catches the ball and shoots it. Then he also does a drop step, a jump shot, and then a dunk. And tennis has mainly focuses on more of a footwork. Okay, so there is a jab step, there is gravity step, then there is a lot of lateral movements on court. Then a main is a pivotal step, then lateral crossovers, lateral shuffle. So these are all the basic footwork and a jump smash in tennis. So we can clearly see that every sport has different movements and every sport has different tactics. Okay. So now let us see how in these games the knee injury occur. So this we can see that while landing, the upper limb is rotating inwards. Okay, so from a jump landing, the upper leg is rotating inwards on a planted leg. Then here we can see the knee is hyperextending. Okay, so again, there are these pivotal movements, there are cutting movements, there are hyperextensions. Okay, medial rotation of the upper limb. So these are the basic movement mechanics where the injuries occur during a high level intensity sports. Okay, so let's see, there's one animation on how ACL tear will occur in at such a high intensity. So generally there is medial rotation and then there's also a hyperextension. So this is how the ACL will generally tear. Okay, so Adhkar sir has already told us about surgery and in an amazing way. And I'm sure that all of you now know and are well versed with knee surgery. So now my job is to tell you how will we do rehabilitation and get the player back to playing his game. Okay, so return back to sports, may it be post-operative, certain goals to achieve and within 6 months. So what are these goals we need to achieve in 6 months? So first we need full knee range of motion in flexion. Okay, so the full leg bending, there should be a full range of motion in bending, or also we call as flexing, and there should be also full knee extension. So leg should be properly straight also. So we need the full range of motion, which is crucial. Then there should not be any pain, there should not be any swelling. Okay, then we need to look for the postures in the functional movement. So we need to see a proper squat movement, we need to see proper lunge movement. Then calf raises are very important. Then balancing exercises, we also call as proprioception or neuromuscular stability exercises, are very crucial. Then one of the basic thing or basic fundamental thing is maintaining the strength and symmetrically it should be equal in both the legs. So there has been a lot of research regarding symmetry in both the legs. So what a physiotherapist will see is that both the legs are equally strong and also the movement which the player is doing is on both the legs, which is symmetrical. So we need to see the symmetry in both the legs, which is very important. Then at 6 to 8 weeks, we allow stationary cycle. We also allow swimming at 6 to 8 weeks. And then by 6 months, you should have leg strength, which is bilaterally symmetrical. There should be proprioception and neuromuscular balance control on the knee. Then there should be correct functional movements and there should be full range of motion without any pain or swelling. So at 6 months, these are the primary goals which we need to achieve. And once we achieve these primary goals, we can go to a more sport-specific approach. So before starting any sport-specific approach, a physiotherapist will see the basic functional movement. So different functional movements, if there are flexible, if they are, their trunk control is good, their core stability is good, their balance is good, then their basic functional movements like squatting, lunging, they are symmetrical and correct. So we always screen the functional movements first. And then we will also see certain, if the player is ready to jump. So jump is a critical movement in all the sports. So we will see how, if the player is jumping both the side equally, or is there any difference in jumping power? Okay, so let's see a video where we will see. There is a single hop test. We see on both the legs. We see triple hop test. On both the legs, both sides should be equal. You see crossover step. So these are the three basic hop tests for distance. Okay. We also see a time test for 6 meter time test. Then a Y balance test is also very important as balance and proprioception is concerned. So after doing this functional test and seeing whether the strength, the balance, the jumping strength is equal in both the legs, plus your movements are good, then we move on to further. Like we tell the patient to jog. So while forward jogging, we see the mechanics should be good. The knee should be facing in front, the hip, ankle, and the knee should be in a straight alignment. Knee should not fall outwards. The knee should not fall inwards. Toes should be pointing straight. So these are the mechanics which we need to see while forward jogging. Then we tell them to do a side shuffle, which is slow at the start. Again, we see the hip should be bent and the knee should be bent. How the patient is having control while doing a side shuffle. So we need to see the technique of every aspect. In front, for forward jogging, side shuffling. Then we can increase the speed of side shuffling by using ladders. But to see if the technique is proper. Then we go to backward jogging. Here also we need to see the proper technique. While coming back, the player has to go on the toes, not planting the full leg. Also knee control. Knee should not face outward again or inward. So we need to see the technique at every movement which we are going to tell the player. Then we can start with single leg sport specific activities. So mainly if we had seen before that many leg sports, they have to balance on one leg. So sport specific movement is mainly a unilateral single leg movement. So while rehabilitation, we need to see that unilateral leg is also taken care of. So we can add a single leg kicking maybe in football. We can add a single leg jab step. We can add a lunge step. So jab step will be in tennis. Lunging will be more in kabaddi. So sport specific single leg exercises we can incorporate. And we can also see a proper technique in the same. Then we can start with low intensity movements, basic like sliding techniques, then jogging. So this will be consisting of more of a warm-up kind of exercises at low intensity. You can do high knees, you can do back kicks. So these are to make the player ready for a high intensity game. So these are all, this is also another. So from the sliding, we go to jumping, side jumping. Again, see the knee control. So we start with slow knee control, see the technique. Look at the knees, if they are in proper technique, not going inwards, not going outwards. Just seeing the stability. Okay. Then for one thing we need to keep in mind that bilaterally strength should be same in both the legs. So we need to achieve that. Research says that 10% difference is allowed, but for any therapist, I think bilaterally symmetrical strength is very, very important. So, and to maintain and improving it is very important. Then proper functional correct pattern of movements is very crucial. Of course, proprioception is crucial. ROM is useful, is very important, and pain, there should be no pain and swelling. So we need to continue rehab even if we have started our jogging and a little low intensity activities. We need to continue our rehabilitation exercises. If the player is doing such kind of movement, our rehabilitation will go again backwards and keep on teaching the player the proper kinetics and kinematics of a jump. If the player is doing the same movement, he or she is again prone to injury. So the rehabilitation is not only to take the player forward, but also to prevent injury. So the proper technique of a squat jump is very, very important, where the player is controlling the knee. The knees are pointed forward. The feet are pointed forwards. Knees are not going in. The stability is maintained. So these techniques are very crucial if we have to go to a sport-specific activity. Then we can also do the same similar activities in a leg press. So these are more of a plyometric activities. So pushing through the toes and decelerating and slow deceleration, fast concentric activity. Then we can teach them plyometric box drop jumps. Okay, so player has to drop and maintain the balance. Okay, so that maintaining the balance and staying there is very crucial. Maintaining the stability when you come down is very important at the start. Okay, we can see once more, the player has to drop off the box and then stabilize himself. Then we can see jump on the box. So here there should be a soft landing. There should be, the knee should be stable on the box. The box shouldn't wobble. Okay, so basic. So it should not wobble. They should be stable on the box like player had shown us before. Similarly, while going all these jumping movements, power movements, we always have to stress to continue the rehab. There should not be any pain. If there is any pain, if the techniques are poor, our rehabilitation will take the player back to the basics. And again, we will have to come back or we have to go forward. So we need to continuously check for the movement. We need to check for the symmetry of strength. We need to check for balance, range of motion, and there should not be pain or swelling. Pain or swelling will indicate the rehabilitation is not proper. So we need to go back and see what went wrong. So we need to keep on continuing the rehab and going forward ahead. So that is important. So we can then incorporate with a little bit of agility drills. So agility is very important for all the sports, and the player needs to rehearse the movement several times, practice the movement slowly. So depending on the sport, we can give them a different agility drills. So backward movements, forward movements, diagonal movements, maintaining the knee control. So several different exercises can be done. So we can give them lateral shuffle. Lateral shuffle is important in tennis. Tennis has doesn't have more of forward backward, but more of a lateral movement. So the training will shift more on the lateral side. Then football will have front and backward movement. Kabaddi will be having more of a lunging, squatting. So depending on the sport, we can give them. So figure of eight movement is very crucial for football kind of movement, basketball. So figure of eight is also very important, where player practices all in all directions. So we can give them balance on one leg and lunging in different directions. This is another important movement for tennis and kabaddi. So depending on the sport, we can give them different drills, forward drills and agility drills, but player has to maintain strength in both the legs. So that is important in rehab perspective. Okay, so basic rules and principles which we use for rehabilitation is never stop the rehabilitation exercises. Maintain, I have seen many players that they stop the rehabilitation once the physio has done his or her, like the visits are over. The player comes back with pain and some patellofemoral problems after the surgery. And so because they are not doing rehabilitation exercises. So this is very important that player keeps on doing rehabilitation exercises, keeps on advancing over it, goes to a physio, sees for the limb symmetry, sees if there is any problem in the leg. That is very important, and continuation of rehab exercises is very, very crucial. Maintaining leg symmetry, which I'm always telling, is very, very important. Achieving your proper quadriceps and hamstring ratio, even your abductor-adductor symmetry is very, very important. So don't neglect strength of lower body and core. Also, balancing exercises are important because balancing exercises help you avoid fall. Okay, so these are very, very important exercises. And also, a good flexibility is important because flexibility is required in all the sports. So, after doing all these, we are ready to play and we are ready to achieve that high intensity of game. We hope this presentation was useful. I think we are ready for questions. Thank you,
Kashmira. It was a nice presentation, very informative one. We had few questions which were answered. If any of our viewers have any questions, they can write it on question and answer segment. And if you have any complaints, you can get contact with us on this number you are seeing on your screen right now.
Thanks, Ravi, for coordinating the session. There are a couple of questions which we have already answered. As Ravi has already said, if any of the viewer has any query, would like to have more information, would like to answer those things, or you can write to us on this email address and we will revert soon. There is a query that can MMT in wide zone be repaired or meniscectomy is needed? See, MMT means medial meniscus tear. So there are certain reports in recent literature where they have recommended repairing such lesions, but they need to present early. Delayed presentation, definitely chances of healing go down. And then in such cases, we can use things like PRP or blood clots to hasten or augment the repair, because in wide zone, blood supply is less and healing chances are very poor. Again, whether the lesion or a meniscus needs to be repaired or trimmed, it depends not just on which zone it is injured, but also how it is injured. When it is a complex tear, which tissue is very friable. Again, when patient presents to the clinician, if it is more than 6 weeks, then chances of healing go down. So early presentation is very important. So these are the factors based on which we decide intraoperatively whether we need to trim it or whether we need to repair it. Kashmira, there is a question for you.
Poonam Patil wants to know, she is physiotherapist herself. She has a patient with right MCL injury 8 weeks back. Whenever he does calf stretches, he has pain in the right ankle. She has started with his ankle strengthening. Do you have any suggestions for her?
So MCL injury.
Yes.
Okay. So mainly calf, if he has pain in the calf. So can you is he playing? Or I need some more, know about that patient.
Her but question when she has started her patient on calf stretches, but when he does those exercises, he has pain in his right ankle. Though the patient had MCL injury, okay. Now the patient is having pain in right ankle.
Yeah, I don't. Okay, so I think an ankle rehab is important, first of all. And so ankle rehabilitation, maybe he must be having some, sprain in the ankle. There may be some swelling in the ankle. So these are the two things which I can rule out. Swelling because maybe of MCL injury, or there must be ankle sprain which he might be having. So So we need to see to it that ankle rehabilitation is done very well. So your intrinsics, your posterior tibialis posterior muscle. So strengthening your tibialis posterior will be helpful. Even your intrinsic muscle activity plus certain balancing exercises that will help the player. And also maybe icing will help the player to reduction of pain. I don't think calf stretching has led to any ankle pain, maybe. But if it is ankle, so it could be most commonly ankle sprain.
There could be an associated ankle injury.
Let me just add a couple of things here. You know, what happens many times when there is some major injury, complete attention, not just patients, but the clinician treating doctor's attention is towards that major injury, and often these minor injuries are missed and then they present after a couple of weeks. So as Kashmira rightly said, there is no relation between the calf stretches and ankle. There could be some injury which was missed earlier and now patient is complaining pain. So proper ankle rehab is required in this patient. Okay. So okay. There is a question about meniscus transplant. So meniscus transplant is a surgery done in patients who are symptomatic, who are having pain post meniscectomy. So meniscus is trimmed and a person is having symptoms. So there are certain prerequisites. So whether meniscus transplant is possible? Yes. It is a cadaver transplant. So meniscus harvested from a cadaver and we get it from various cadaver labs from outside India. So these tissues are completely tested for all the viruses and to avoid any chance of virus transmission or disease transmission. But prerequisites are the joint should be properly aligned. There should not be any osteoarthritic changes. And then we need to get scans to measure the exact anteroposterior and the mediolateral diameter of the dimensions of the tibia. And same, based on that, the meniscus size, same size meniscus, we need, communicated to the lab. And then that tissue is transported to the hospital and which can be implanted arthroscopically and through mini open surgery. Another question is on the meniscus tear and ACL injury. Can they heal automatically? So let me answer regarding meniscus tear. Meniscus tear, small tear in the outer zone, the red zone, can heal with rest, provided we give proper rest and then restrict our activities. Small tears, but large tears, they will never heal and they may extend. Okay, but tears in the white zone where there is no blood supply, they never heal. So meniscus tear, symptomatic meniscus tear, arthroscopy is a must. To repair or trim, both the options. And ACL, if there is a partial injury, sometimes it is mentioned on MRI, there is partial injury or incomplete injury or a sprain, ACL sprain. Such incomplete injuries can heal. But the current literature says if it is incomplete injury, it leads to weak ACL. And then that knee joint remains unstable. So intrinsic healing potential of complete ACL tear is very poor. They never heal. Incomplete injuries, even if they heal, ACL remains weak. I mean, the current literature, in fact, there are, as all of us are aware, there are two bundles of ACL, anteromedial and posterolateral. Even if one bundle is injured, that needs to be reconstructed. But a person is able to give up his sports career, then with knee brace and physiotherapy, this can be compensated. So ACL will never heal, but knee will remain asymptomatic if we compensated with knee brace and restrictive activities. I hope I have answered your question, Mr. Nikam.
Nikita has question that how will the prognosis be for a patient with anterior dislocation following multi-ligament injury along with peroneal nerve injury?
Nikita, how will the prognosis be for patient with anterior dislocation following multi-ligament injury along with peroneal? See, peroneal nerve injury and multi-ligament injury, these two are different issues. So on day one, peroneal nerve injury, if it is there, that now needs to be explored and repaired if there is injury. And if it is stretched out, then the current literature suggests peroneal nerve grafting for the peroneal nerve. And if there is multi-lig injury, then collateral ligaments are repaired first. Knee is stabilized and range of movement is attained. And after that, cruciate ligaments are repaired. So that's how the protocol would be. But the person presents late, then there are various techniques for the ligament reconstruction and delayed presentation for peroneal nerve injury. Any role for surgical exploration is not there, and rather results of exploration for peroneal nerve now are poor. There is a query regarding some hospital has not done a single transplant, but in city of Pune, meniscus transplant have been done earlier. Probably you need to get anonymous attendee need to get more information regarding this.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Neeraj Adkar, sir. Thank you very much, Dr. Kashmira. We had a nice discussion about knee, most common knee injuries in sports and rehabilitation, along with all treatment options. I would like to tell my audience, due to some technical difficulties from Zoom, we couldn't go live earlier on Facebook and YouTube, but the whole webinar is available on Sai Shri's Facebook and YouTube page now. You can get back to us on this address you can see on the screen, or email and website, all the contact numbers are there. I would also like to tell my audience that we are coming again with webinar 3.0. The topic will be osteoporosis and neck and back pain. So thank you all the attendees. We will see you soon.
Thank you, Ravi, and thank you, Kashmira. Thank you very much.
Thank you.